Now, it's very rare that one of my own personal heroes enters this studio, but by golly, it's happened. Alan Partridge, Alpha Papa, is out in cinemas today, and Armando Iannucci is in the studio with me.
Hello.
Hello, Armando Iannucci.
I just wonder how many people were disappointed when you said Alan Partridge, and everyone thought, oh, he's here.
Well, we had Coogan on the show last week, so it's fine.
Oh, right, OK. Well, so it's nice to come back for sloppy seconds.
You're the dessert.
Yes.
Oh, the glorious dessert. Long-awaited doesn't even begin to cover it, really. Why now? Why the Alan Partridge film now?
I don't know. I mean, people, not us, but people have been talking about it for 10 years. Us doing
those scumbags.
And your words, not mine. And we thought, we'll only do a film when we feel the time is right, when we've got the right story, when we wrote the script before we took it to anyone to finance and so on. And we felt confident about it. And with Mid-Morning Matters, his North Norfolk digital radio show, his online web presence, which, as he says, gives him an audience potentially of 6 billion people.
Yes.
We thought the time now is... the world is ready for Alan.
Yeah, digital Alan.
Digital Alan. Digi-Alan. So that, yes. And we were pleased with the story and the script and thought, let's go.
Mm. Was there ever a chance that you were going to direct it? Obviously, you're very busy with other projects and stuff.
I kind of knew that I was going to be busy, but I also very early on I said I don't think I should direct it because I think with the film it needs a fresh pair of eyes, someone seasoned but who knows his comedy and who could just give it that sense of working towards the scale of the, you know, the big screen. We'll make sure that it doesn't lose any essence of Alan in that kind of...
You're the canon transfer, protectors.
That sort of thing, and, you know, there is always a danger when you transfer something that is known elsewhere into a film that you're tempted to go very big with it. You've got a whole big train set to play with. And what we've done in this film is kind of gone the opposite, almost out of spite.
Yeah, it's all kind of set in one place.
It's set in a small radio station that's under siege. Yeah. So it's Alan doing what he does best, but there's an element of danger involved in it as well.
I think when we spoke to Steve, that's kind of one of the points I made. Alan's, I think, at its best when it's intimate, you know what I mean? Like, Mid-Morning Matters was like two cameras, series set in travel taverns, you know, a caravan, a lot of stuff.
The idea of him being confined, really.
Yeah, this huge personality.
He wants the world, you know, and yet when you look at where he's at physically, he's in the smallest space possible.
He's only ever in a room, isn't he, really? I mean, I guess even from the earliest radio series, you know, he was interviewing, you know, Formula One racing drivers in, you know, a radio studio, a set, a theatre.
I know. I've never really seen it that way, but I suppose you're right in that he's always trapped in these four walls. Even though he's got the whole world as his oyster.
Would he be good in kind of like a Die Hard film, just stuck in like a air conditioning pipe or something?
Yes, but if he was in a Die Hard film, he would be stuck in that pipe from beginning to end.
Yeah, and he'd never get out.
Even after Bruce Willis had rescued everyone else and gone home, Alan would still be going, hello?
There'd just be pools of urine coming out of vents everywhere.
But every now and then, pulling his phone out and doing little kind of diary pieces, you know, because it might be, you know, if he's found dead, fossilised 1,000 years from now, they would be able to work out from what's on the phone. You know, assuming that technology doesn't upgrade between now and 1,000 years' time, they'd be able to work out,
we
you know,
still
lots
access
of
the RAM chips.
Yes.
We spoke also to Tim Kay a little while ago, and he was sort of saying that he operates best when he's petrified, and basically his whole sort of system with dealing with the situation of acting with both Alan Partridge and Steve Coogan as well. Does Steve kind of understand how big he is and how big Alan Partridge is, both as entities? You know,
he sort of does and he doesn't. I think he does in that he knows that various people who are like guests on the project are nervous because
and they grew
Steve
up with him.
And so on. So he does his very best to talk them through and to help them out and to really kind of bring them on board. On the other hand, you know, we do operate the very highest standards in terms. So we're always like having discussions about every line.
Yeah.
And I imagine that's unnerving in front of a performer who's just come on set to see us like going into a corner mumbling, because then they must think, was it about me? Is it me?
they're gonna put cigarettes out of my arm next time.
Or are they just going to cut me? Do I get shot at this point? Is that what happens? Have they just decided to rewrite the film so that I'm just carted off?
Obviously Alan shot someone before.
Yes, he has. So that's why he's no longer on television.
Yeah.
Because he killed someone on live television.
Yeah. I guess in a film you can actually shoot someone and, you know, be able to live with the consequences because it's its own kind of entity.
Except we've played this for real, the siege. You know, it's basically another DJ, an older DJ who is going to be fired because there's a lot of rebranding going on in the station. And and he just kind of loses the plot and brings a shotgun in and insists he carries on doing his show. So he's basically just crossed a certain line in his head.
Well, the strange thing is that with Absolute Radio, we're actually in the midst of a takeover. And
are you?
When the first announcement went out and we had a big meeting about it, I walked in the room and said, just sack Pat. Okay. nobody had seen the film. Nobody had seen it yet. So it was kind of like, I was the only one who had seen the film. So it didn't really make any sense to anybody.
Well, the station in the film is rebranded and renamed Shape.
Yeah. Yes.
The way you want it to be, which you can imagine anyone over 50 with 30 years broadcast experience behind them
would just vomit
having to say. But what was it? But to make it real, we thought, once the siege happens, let's do it for real. Mm. What actually happens? So we spoke to the police. We got a siege expert in who talked us through what really genuinely does go on.
And there will occasionally be lulls in the situation and stuff,
and they will like commandeer someone else's flat who has a good view of the city, you know. So this poor family has suddenly got police superintendents and, you know, siege negotiators in, and they're just making endless cups of tea for them while they kind of
do their job,
stare out the window and see if there's any movement. So and we've incorporated all that, so we thought, once the siege happens, we play it out absolutely for real. There's no comedy to be got out of
the situation itself.
It's what the people inside make of it, especially Alan,
who
is given this chance to think, oh, hang on, I know I gave up being on the national stage a while ago, but
this could be good for
me. There is an opportunity here. So that's how it plays.
We spoke about Steve and Alan being massive pieces of work in the comedy environs that we kind of inhabit. Do you understand how big you are in that particular scheme of things? Because you've worked on pretty much every major British comedy show in the last, you know, 20 years.
Well, I mean, I know that there are fans, and, you know, I grew up big fan of comedy. You know, I would crease myself up watching Blackadder, Not 9 o'clock News, and you know, my early comedy was just imitations of the sort of comedy that I liked.
Yeah.
So I'm always heartened. I'm always heartened.
Harper Collins.
I'm always
Harper Collins.
You're just doing adverts for publishers now. What's going on? I was thinking of Harpic.
I'm always Harpic. The cleaner,
the detergent, or whatever. when someone comes up and says, yeah, I've just started in comedy and, you know, I've got tapes of all your shows and, you know, I've been copied, I think, great, it's nice that if there's a generation that's grown up on my stuff or the stuff I've done with, you know, the people I've collaborated with, then that's great. But I try not to think too hard about the responsibility.
With great power. We did, Steve, the week before last, I think it was,
Are you doing me now?
I'm doing you hard,
right, okay.
Sir. You don't
I feel
mind me
done. Yeah.
Well done? Badly done.
Welcome to Battery Presenters. Battery Guests.
We spoke about, he injects Partridge with a little bit of engineering knowledge because that's something he finds fascinating.
Yeah.
Do the best comedians have outside interests and have a bit of a background? Because obviously Peter Burnham, for example, he was in the Merchant Navy. It's kind of like that fascinating kind of background that you kind of can bring into a character because you've lived another life.
Well, unfortunately, my interests are astronomy and classical music.
Milton.
So I find very little outlet for that in terms of comedy characters who were trying to make every man kind of people.
You could do a good Guardian Easter piece,
maybe. So I don't know how much I bring in. But I've always lived, you see, I've always lived outside London. I've always lived in the suburbs. I think what I bring to Alan is that whole world of planning permission.
Yeah. Daily Mail.
Daily Mail, Texas.
Neighbours,
Local Tesco stores opening up where you just don't want them. clogging up the roads and the school run with their roadworks.
Yeah.
You know, that sort of
mundane kind of
that bitterness of day-to-day kind of middle age. I think I bring a bit of that too.
Is there a bit of Pat in you? Could you imagine going postal somewhere? Is there...
All right, I see. Yeah. Who says I haven't done or have no plans to?
If we went to your house, you could find the blueprints for some kind of siege.
Yeah. I mean, you'll find me every day outside wherever the next Tesco's to be built. Yeah. You'll probably see me there.
Yeah.
you know, just stalking the place.
Just looking around.
Just trying to work out which one is the project manager.
Yeah, which...
And then
which,
following him home.
Which joist to blow up to reduce the whole thing to rubble. Did working on In the Loop kind
spillage
of...
Spillage and bagging area. I'll give them spillage and bagging area.
Please return your entrails to the packing area. Did working on In the Loop and obviously writing In the Loop prepare you for that kind of big sort of movie arc, so to speak?
Yes. It introduced me to, you know, what's the joy of doing a film as opposed to a 30-minute regular weekly show, and also what the pitfalls are and the things to avoid. I mean, the great thing is you've got to. It's more in terms of the story. When you're doing a series, you've got to get all your plots up and running in the first 5 minutes because you've only got 30 minutes to work them all out. You've sort of got to get, at the end, you've kind of got to get back to where you started so that you can do another episode next week.
Yeah.
But the film, you don't have to do that. You can introduce something 40 minutes in, an hour in.
Yeah.
You know, the last 20 minutes, something new can crop up. And actually, you can then do things to them. You know, you can take them to a place that's very different at the end from where they were at the start. And the pacing also, you know, you can be very fast and frenetic in 30 minutes and sustain that. You don't want to do that for 90 minutes because it becomes intolerable.
Yeah.
You actually are looking for those moments where it's actually funnier if there's a bit of a, not a lull, but the pacing of the comedy is a bit different. You can afford to really look at a moment a little bit longer in the film and get the comedy out of that, and then bang, it all kicks off again for the next 10 or 15 minutes.
I'm sort of fascinated by the Gibbons brothers, how sort of how they get such a nuanced character as Alan Partridge at a young age.
They're only in the sort of early 30s, and they grew up listening and watching Alan, and a lot of people write Alan and send it in to us. And
it's a caricature, isn't it?
It can be funny, but it's always Alan's greatest hits. It's the one or two things people like about Alan, 100 times bigger.
Yeah.
What Rob and Neil Gibbons managed very early on was to get the tone absolutely right.
Yeah.
Just the level to play it at, so that it never became a caricature. It always felt, and it felt both the Alan that we knew, but also a believable development of Alan, because Alan now is in he's in a slightly more relaxed phase. I think he's a bit comfortable being a big fish in a small pond rather than these aspirations towards national fame. It's only when the siege happens and it becomes a national news story that he realises that potentially the whole world could be watching.
How important were the Gibbons to rejuvenating the canon, everyone's interest
essential.
In him?
I don't think we could have done Mid-Morning Matters and the book, certainly the book and the film, all in this short period of time without him. I mean, having them there and being able to rely on them and them have faith in us and you know, just take from us the kind of responsibility for writing, it just meant that we knew that we could keep the work and Alan going on a day-by-day basis.
Yeah.
Because prior to that, what would happen is Steve and I would meet for like a week every month, and then we'd go our separate ways, do our projects, come back a month later, write for another week. But it's very difficult to get the momentum going.
Yeah, and if you've got like a baseline of just people plodding away.
It keeps happening, and then we can see it happening, and then we can comment on it as it goes, and then we can meet up and take it to the next stage. And then we know that if we are heading off into separate little projects, it's going to keep going. The film's going to keep being written and we'll get there.
What I like about your Twitter feed, and you're excellent on Twitter. Most of my favourite sort of things I find, like the Jakey App Radio 4 thing that I hadn't heard before. and Bits and Bobs. And you drip feed morsels of kind of unseen Partridge from all scripts and stuff.
Document.
How big is this document? You realise how sickening that is to most Partridge
fans. It's 200 pages long, this document. And it's bits of Alan we've come up with over the last 22 years that we haven't
kind of put it
into,
banged in.
In fact, I'm now discovering that some of it has made it into stuff and I've just forgotten.
and someone will
occasionally
pick
I've tweeted, here's a bit of Unseen Alan, and within a second,
someone's
gone
got
back,
a YouTube clip.
Series 2, program 5, 22 minutes in, he says that. So, but fundamentally, a lot of it is unseen. Yeah. I mean, a lot of it is unseen. For a reason,
yeah. You know? How much have you sort of redacted? Sorry, big black
pen. But it's very easy to come up with things for Alan to say. Mm. Yeah, that's the easy bit. The hard bit in the writing is to make it work
make it emotional, make it
in
kind of
terms of what else is around him, and make those other characters feel very real and believable and funny at the same time.
Mid Morning Matters, there's talk of possibly returning.
I think that's his next contractual obligation.
It's a contractual, okay.
Unless
so
Alan
will happen,
is,
then.
Is too full of himself now after the. Well, I don't know how successful the film's going to be because it's only open today. But
well, it is an excellent piece of art, let me tell you.
Oh, thank you very much.
The weirdest thing, I went to see it with my dad, kind of like preview press screening. I pretended that he was my producer for the day because me and my dad. This, you know, we don't have spot to talk about comedy's kind of our thing that we share. And
so any expenses, would you be claiming that back? Or would you be claiming your own expenses back but not your dad's, because that's not really...
Yeah, exactly. So if anybody from the Inland Revenue is listening, that's basically, you know, that massive yoghurt my dad ate is definitely
is not tax deductible.
Yeah, exactly. No. But we went over the road and we started talking about the pixel density of a Primark display. And I thought that's the most Partridge thing anyone has ever done. Coming out of Partridge, we had a big old argument about it, but I'm not really sure how I got into that. But
we were talking about how great the film was.
Yes, that's right.
Just
it's very
kind
good.
Of steer you back.
Me,
to that.
Thank you very much. There's a responsibility on your part, at least, to bring us back. But it's such a glorious piece of work, and it's one of those ones that I think everybody coming out of there would be just kind of like a big, you know, outtake of breath, sort of going, oh, I'm glad it's good, because you know, it's so hard to get that sort of thing wrong. People just go a bit mad. They have a bit more of a budget, and just they take it to a different country, they bring in guest stars, they bring it, you know.
Well, that's why, as I said, we wrote the script first and then we, you know, raised the money for it, because what we didn't want was the temptation as you're doing this process of developing something to say, hey, can we get Clooney in?
but there must be big stars
set in Helsinki, you know, and all that sort of thing.
Space Alan.
No. No. Underwater Alan, perhaps.
Yeah, maybe.
You know, I can see that.
Yeah.
But...
Well, again, he'd be in a very oppressive kind of underwater station.
He'd be in a sort of tank in an aquarium, kind of trapped.
Submarine Alan. Perfect. Yeah.
So how many torpedoes do you have? Have you ever fired a torpedo in anger? I suppose it gets quite dull.
Yeah.
Being a kind of torpedo polisher.
Turns out Partridge writes itself.
So. It writes itself. Yeah.
Really.
Do you actually polish the torpedoes, or do you find...
They always look shiny, don't they?
They look shiny. Yeah. I mean, I can't imagine that there's wear and tear, because... That would imply you'd used them before. But,
You don't want to see a roughed up torpedo, do you? With entrails on it.
Do you have like string on the back of the torpedo? So
to bring it, drag it back.
Drag it back in case you've missed.
There we go, bang it.
Tell me about the women's quarters. I apologise for my terrible impression of Alan, by the way.
But when you guys do read-throughs and stuff, and when
you all do Alan
in front of Steve,
as Alan,
which is very strange.
I know, it is. He's the best, though.
Yeah, he is the best. That's it. But you would make capable understudies,
I'm
imagine.
I'm not sure.
Got a bit of a Scottish twang. Right. How far along are you with the third season of Veep?
We start shooting in September, the third season. Second season, I think, comes out in October here.
Right, okay. I was watching. I just mashed through the whole first season, second season on a plane, a long haul, and I sat on a play on words. I don't do jokes, but Hoisted by Your Own Retard was one that I would use at dinner parties in polite conversation, and I heard it on Vimeo. I was like, oh. Balls, so, you know. I've been sat on that for it, and it's, do you ever sort of write jokes that you know that you sit on for a while and then they get
somebody
done
else
by someone else?
Yeah, I'm trying to think that has happened. What happens though is we write stuff in Veep and in Thick of It, and then it actually happens in real life.
Right, the
and
actual
then
kind
we
of
think,
plot.
Well, we've got to scrub this now because. If people start thinking we're being topical by doing this now, you
know, and that ages it, I suppose. If
it
you
does,
do something that actually happens.
So how did that? But this is stupid. We wrote this as a stupid story. Why has this actually happened?
Well, you know, you say like history repeats itself all the time. You should just like concern yourself about the Peterloo Massacre or something.
But
like that.
In America, there's this congressman who resigned because he tweeted pictures of his own
penis
to someone. So he's then thought 18 months later, I know, I'll run for mayor of London, for mayor of New York.
Yeah.
And has then had to admit that he carried on tweeting pictures of his groin to people, but he or posting them up online under the pseudonym Carlos Danger. Now, why is that real? Why did that actually happen? I don't understand.
It's incredible, isn't it? It really is incredible piece of work.
And why did you think, Do you know what? I think I'll run for mayor of New York because I've got to think now. Is there anything that could come? No. I mean, there's a Carlos Danger groin. That aside, I think I'm all right.
Yeah, I mean, just give it up. You know, you've already, you know, if it comes up.
Que sera.
If my groin comes up.
Yeah. I'll say that was a long time ago.
That's Carlos Danger's deal, you know. nobody hated Brad Pitt in Fight Club, so, you know, it was an alter ego. It's my alter ego, it's fine. Yes. You said you wouldn't be averse to resurrecting the thick of it for like a bit of a special. Mm-hmm. Has the good doctor kind of put the kibosh on that a little bit?
Well, I always said it was the end of Malcolm. Mm. No one believed me.
Right, okay.
It is the end of Malcolm.
Right. It is actually the end of Malcolm.
I felt we took it to a nice, neat kind of conclusion.
Yeah.
And I'm averse to opening all that up again.
Right, okay.
Doesn't mean to say I'll go back and look at, you know, UK politics and something, but I kind of feel we've covered a fair amount with the thick of it canon.
Yeah.
So let's leave it at that.
Yeah. Is there any chance of you sort of getting back into the kind of the election night specials and stuff like that?
Oh, right.
I think some of my favourite stuff was like the Tony Blair, Humpty Dumpty.
Oh, yeah.
I've been caught on a long lens is a favourite phrase.
And Sally Phillips on a helicopter bringing the first scandal. We waited till the first MP was announced and then Sally Phillips dressed as a harlot because the thing was harlot in a helicopter. Then touched down in his constituency and started putting rumours around about him and her.
That sounds like somebody had a budget and you went, right, we're having a helicopter. We're having a harlot in a helicopter.
Yeah. I mean, we didn't pay harlot prices.
No.
We just paid for a helicopter. It was
actress.
It was an actual
play.
Actress prices.
Cheaper than a harlot. Who knew?
So, what was the question? Oh, yeah. Election stuff. No, I love all that. That's all good. And I was very fortunate to be around in America when it was the Obama re-election. I was there in Washington on election
night. Right, okay. That's a grotesque approximation of what we do over here, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, the amount of money sloshing around is extraordinary.
Yeah.
But I was outside, I found myself outside the White House in the evening.
Oh, right, okay.
With Obama's victory being announced. And that was good fun.
I think you said before, like, he's really good at getting elected, but he's finding the presidency harder than actually getting elected.
Then who'd have thought?
Who knew?
It's a tough job.
Well, he loves his drones and his shiny missiles, presumably.
Shiny drones. String on the end of his drone. What?
Amanda, thank you so much for joining us. It's been really, 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 really awesome. I hope I haven't come out as so much of a fanboy, but thank you for coming down.
It's all right. Just, you know. Just stop back touching off.
Shine my missile.